Thank you for joining us for the webinar today. I am Amrita Roy, a scientist from ACD Bio Group. Before we begin, I would like to let everyone know that the audience will be automatically muted for the duration of the webinar. If you have a question, please use the Q&A function to the right of the WebEx window. Please address your question to all panelists, and my colleagues will respond to your queries in real time. In the event we are unable to get to your question, we will follow up with you offline after the webinar. The webinar is being recorded and will be on our website soon. For a quick overview of the topics I'll be covering today, I will begin with a bird's eye view of RNAscope technology, followed by a general assay workflow and troubleshooting guidelines. I will also talk about how to interpret the assay results with some FAQs. And lastly, I will add some COVID-related applications and tools from ACD Bio to facilitate your COVID-19 related research. So let's begin by asking the question, what is RNAscope? RNAscope assay is an in situ hybridization technique that utilizes a unique double Z target probe design followed by a signal amplification system that allows you to visualize a single mRNA transcript as a punctured dot. RNAscope allows both chromogenic and fluorescent labeling and is compatible with a wide variety of samples, including FFP, fixed frozen, fresh frozen, cultured adherent and non-adherent cell lines. The growth and adoption of this technology is best exemplified by the number of peer-reviewed publications. Since our first publication in 2011, there has been an increasing awareness of our technology, and currently we have over 2,752 peer-reviewed papers published in numerous journals, including many top-tier ones. Also, the RNAscope technology is highly relevant across multiple fields of research, with over 40% of the publications in cancer research. Neuroscience and infectious disease are another two popular fields of interest. More recently, the incorporation of RNAscope technology into single-cell RNA-seq workflow is demonstrated through the rapid growth of publications using the assay to confirm and spatially map single-cell RNA-seq data in the tissue context. With over 80% of these single-cell papers in very high-impact journals, including Nature, Cell, and Science. Here is a brief overview of the RNAscope workflow. RNAscope assay is a slide-based assay and is intended for use on sample types similar to that used with immunohistochemistry or immunofluorescence. The assay starts with permeabilizing the samples with reagents provided in the pretreatment kit. Pre-treatment enables unmasking of the target mRNAs, thus allowing the probe to penetrate into the cell and hybridize with the target RNA sequence. The probe is a pool of oligos that are designed using our established bioinformatics algorithm, which allows for target specificity. A series of amplification cascade then amplifies the signal. And RNA molecules are then visualized under the microscope as punctured dots. Signal can also be quantified semi-quantitatively or quantitatively using image analysis software. The primary feature of our RNAscope technology is the oligo-based double Z probe design. Each Z probe has a power lower part that is 25 bases in length, and it is complementary to the target RNA. The upper region is a 14-base tail sequence that has the pre-amplifier binding site. The upper and the lower parts of the Z probe are linked together by a spacer sequence. Two such Z probes must come together to create a 50 base specific binding site that hybridizes with the target region of interest. The informatics algorithm that is used to design these probes ensures that the oligonucleotide sequences are specific and do not cross-hybridize with any other sequence. The top of the Z is the base for the amplification structure. When two Zs hybridize, it creates a binding site upon which a preamplifier can bind and the amplification tree can be built. A standard RNAscope probe for a target sequence of 1,000 bases or more consists of about 20 double Z pairs pulled together that are designed to hybridize next to each other along a target region. This allows for a tremendous amount of amplification and signal potential. However, only a few ZZ pairs are needed to bind to the target RNA sequence to generate enough signal for molecular detection. Here is a schematic showing the hybridization and the subsequent amplification of the RNAscope assay. The double Z probe will bind to the target mRNA transcript. Once the double Z probe binds, it serves as the foundation and binding site for the preamplifier molecule. Once the preamplifier is bound, it serves as the binding site for the amplifier molecules. And each amplifier can further bind multiple label probes, sequentially hybridizing to assemble a branching complex at each ZZ binding. Label probes can contain an enzyme such as horse redox peroxidase that generates a visible signal after chromogenic reaction, such as with DAB, that is detectable under a standard bright field microscope. These label probes can also contain fluorophores that allow for visualization of the signals under a fluorescent microscope. This signal amplification strategy provides for visualization of target RNA as a single dot, where each dot represents an individual RNA molecule. If a single Z binds to the target mRNA transcript, the preamplifier cannot bind, as it needs both Zs to provide the binding site. Helps to ensure the specificity of the probes and helps reduce potential background staining. In order to detect multiple mRNA simultaneously, multiple amplification trees must be built. That being said, we must ensure the specificity. The specificity is ensured by adding a unique tail sequence to the probes. This means the double Z probe design, we add a tail sequence that is indicative of a channel designator. For example, C1 probe has a specific C1 tail sequence that will only allow for binding of the subsequent C1 preamplifier, amplifier, and label probe molecules. Similarly, a C2 probe will have a separate and unique tail sequence, and so on. So the C1 and C2 are the channel designators. We have chromogenic singleplex brown or red assay and duplex assay on both manual and automated platforms. The multiplex fluorescent assay allows detection of up to 3 targets for V1 assay or up to 4 targets for V2 assay, and with the highplex kit up to 8 or 12 targets simultaneously in a single tissue section. The difference between the V1 and the V2 fluorescent assay is that the V2 assay uses opal fluorophores from Parking-Elmer or Akoya Biosciences for signal visualization, whereas in the V1 assay, as well as the highplex assay, the fluorophores are conjugated and are included in the assay kit from ACD Bio. We also have some assays available on automation platforms like the Leica Bond RX or Ventana Discovery. For RNAscope, both the chromogenic singleplex and duplex assays are available on Leica and Ventana. The V2 fluorescent assay is currently available only with Leica platform. In case your target of interest is shorter than 300 base pairs, it is below the detection limit of RNAscope. And in such situations, BaseScope would be the right choice of assay for you. Currently, BaseScope is available on both manual and automation platforms. If you are interested in the automation platform, please contact your local account manager. We have our field application specialist available for training and troubleshooting on the automation platforms. The next few slides, let's talk about the RNAscope amplification and detection systems for the manual assays. The diagrams here depict the singleplex amplification system. Pictured here is the amplification tree, which is then tethered by an enzyme. On the left is the red assay that utilizes alkaline phosphatase and is visualized by a fast red chromogen, while on your right is a brown assay that utilizes phosph redox peroxidase and is visualized by chromogen. A brief overview of the duplex amplification is presented here. The two probe channels used here have independent amplification trees. And fast red substrate for visualization of the target, while channel 1 associated amplification tree utilizes green chromogen for the visualization of. Please note that our C1 probes by default are ready to use in 1x concentration, whereas the C2 probes are provided as a 50x tox that are required to be diluted in a 1:50 ratio. Multiplex V1 assay utilizes the same amplification system and is similar to the duplex chromogenic assay. Here, 3 independent amplification trees are built such that the C1, C2, and C3 probes will have their own amplification trees stemming from where the probe has been hybridized to the specific mRNA transcript. The signal can then be visualized from the 3 independent fluorescent label probes. A fluorescent multiplex V2 assay can be used to detect up to 4 mRNA targets. Here, 4 independent amplification trees are built. The C1, C2, C3, and C4 probes will have their individual amplification trees built from the specific mRNA targets. The signal can then be visualized using the Opal dyes or TSA. RNAscope HiPlex allows simultaneous detection of up to 12 targets on the same fresh or fixed frozen tissue sections. This assay is based on ACD's proprietary signal amplification and background suppression technology. Each probe is assigned a specific tail sequence, which is referred to as T1 to T12. These target probes, which can be up to either 8 or 12, are hybridized and amplified together. The signal detection is iteratively achieved in 3 rounds. In each round, we have 4 targets to detect. So this is the first 4 target. After the first round of detection, the fluorophores are cleaved and the second round of targets are detected. cleaving procedure is quick and is chemical based to protect sample morphology and RNA quality. I'll now go on to discuss the RNAscope assay workflow. RNAscope assay can either be run in a single day or you may split it into 2 days. If you decide to perform the assay over 2 days, then one option is to complete the sample preparation and pre-treatment on day one, and then start with the probe hybridization step on day two. Alternatively, you may finish the probe hybridization step on day one that includes 2-hour incubation with probe with subsequent washing with wash buffer, and then leave the slides in 5x SSE solution overnight. On day two, you will perform the amplification steps followed by detection. The second option is preferable, particularly when you are running the duplex or multiplex assay, as these additional amplification steps can longer the procedure. This is an overview of the workflow for singleplex chromogenic assay using paraffin sections or FFPE samples. The singleplex assay can take about 8 hours time. Please refer to part one of the user manual for sample preparation and pre-treatment recommendations. The assay workflow has 4 major steps: pre-treatment, hybridization, amplification, and finally staining and detection. The workflow for FFP and fixed frozen samples will include a heat-mediated target retrieval step followed by protease digestion for pre-treatment. Multiplex B1 assay also includes 4 major steps, but it is a shorter assay. The 3 amplification steps are required to be performed irrespective of the number of targets you are detecting. In the AMP4ALT step that comes after the 3 amplification steps, you are required to choose any one of these 3 combinations provided, which are AMP4ALTA, ALTB, or ALTC. I'll provide further details on these V1 fluorophore combinations later during the course of this presentation. Coming to the multiplex fluorescent V2 assay, as in the other assay types, there are 4 major steps: sample pretreatment, hybridization, amplification, and detection. However, in the V2 assay, during the detection process, the channels are developed sequentially after the amplification step. Unlike in the V1 assay, where the fluorophores are conjugated to AMP4, in the V2 assay, the TSA-based fluorophores are added separately during the detection steps. This offers the flexibility to the user to opt to visualize any of their target using the opal dye of their choice. One important thing to note here is that V2 assay is TSA-based and requires the purchase of opal fluorophores from PerkinElmer or Akoya Biosciences. Hyplex workflow is performed in 3 rounds with 4 targets being detected in each round. Round 1 is the longest, which takes up to 7 to 8 hours and includes probe hybridization and signal amplification steps. In this round, you will also detect the first set of 4 targets and follow it up with imaging. Round 1 imaging. And the next set of 4 targets are iteratively detected using the same 4 fluorophore types followed by imaging. Once all 3 sets of images are generated, they are aligned appropriately with the HyPlex image registration software. FPE samples or paraffin sections, we recommend fixing with 10% NBF for 16 to 32 hours. Using standard ethanol series, followed by xylene incubation. Recommended sample thickness is 4 to 6 microns. And we also recommend that the tissue is mounted onto super frost plus slides for better attachment. In order to preserve RNA quality, it is recommended to store sections with desiccants at room temperature for up to 3 months. For long-term storage, it is best to store at 4 degrees with desiccant. For fresh frozen samples, please review the user manual for detailed recommendations. A few highlights are presented here. We recommend storing fresh frozen tissue blocks or sections airtight at minus 80 for up to 3 months. Recommend sample thickness is 10 to 20 micron, again mounted on super frost plus slides. Our assay are compatible with fixed frozen and cultured sample cell types. Shown on this slide are sample pretreatment recommendations for various sample types to perform RNAscope chromogenic and fluorescent B2 assay. The recommendations shown on this slide are for a manual assay platform, and all the sample types require hydrogen peroxide treatment. With each sample type, we are varying the target retrieval time and protease treatment. For FFP, we recommend 15 minutes target retrieval and use of protease plus for digestion. For fixed frozen, 5 minutes of target retrieval is recommended and a stronger protease 3 is used. However, for fresh frozen samples, target retrieval is not required. Hence, the strongest protease of all, protease 4, is used. Lastly, for cultured cells, again, no target retrieval and a dilution of protease 3 is recommended. And note, these are all for manual assay platform. Let's discuss some of the best practices while running the RNAscope assay. Best practice that we highly recommend is to include controls, both positive and negative, in your assay. Positive controls are used to ensure that the assay workflow is appropriate and also to confirm RNA integrity in your sample. Negative control is used to confirm signal specificity. Single-plex assays use PPIB as a positive control and DAPB as a negative control. PPIB is cyclophilin B, which is a housekeeping gene, and most normal tissues are expected to show moderate PPIB expression, while DAPB is a soil bacterium. DAPB gene is from soil bacterium and should not pick up any signals in samples from other species. For duplex assays, we recommend using a two-plex positive control called R2A and PPIB and two-plex DAPB negative control. For multiplex assays, we recommend a three-plex positive control comprising Pol R2A, PPIB and UBC genes, and as a negative control comprising three-plex DAPB, that means all channels there will be DAPB. Similarly, the HyPlex assays include a 12-plex positive control pool and a 12-plex DAPB negative control pool. That we know what controls to use for various assays, let's see how we can qualify the samples for the assay. If you are working with the RNAscope assay for the first time, then we recommend that you run the positive and negative control probes on ACD provided control slides, such as HILA or 3T3. in order to ensure that the assay that is set up in your lab is optimal. Then proceed to running control probes on your experimental tissues to assess the sample RNA quality and to determine the best pretreatment conditions based on the signal detected and tissue morphology. Next, if your sample passes the QC, you can then move on to running your target probe. Otherwise, it is recommended to verify your technique, check RNA quality, or perform assay optimization. I'll be discussing our scoring guidelines in a later slide. Additionally, to make sure that you have all the items needed for your RNAscope assay, you should have a checklist like this one. Always start working with fresh reagents and use the appropriate assay-specific mounting medium. We also have some recommended general guidelines, such as apply all the amplification reagents in the right order, maintain humidity in the high-busy oven, and several others. Here is a typical example of an RNAscope experiment. We used serial sections from a human lung cancer sample and ran a manual chromogenic RAID assay. What you are seeing is a DAPB negative control image. As mentioned earlier, this probe is from a soil bacterium and therefore gives the expected clean background in a human lung cancer sample. This is a section from the same sample stained with the positive control probe PPIB or cyclophilin B. PPIB is showing strong signals that is fairly uniform across the section, indicating that the RNA quality is good. Now, this is a section stained for immune checkpoint marker PD-L1. Here we observe strong punctate dots indicating expression of PD-L1 in this tumor sample. Based on the control technique, we can determine that the localized expression pattern seen here is real and specific. Now let's talk about a few factors that can impact your assay results and some tips and tricks to overcome them. In this section, we will also go over the various assay types and the recommended conditions for each of them. This slide here shows the detection of PARC-CZ in normal mouse colon tissue using the Brown chromogenic assay. It is an ideal assay for tissues that has alkaline phosphatase-dependent background, such as kidney. This assay is not ideal when using tissues that are subject to pigmentation, such as lungs or skin samples. This is an example of chromogenic RAID assay. The image shows your in stromal cells. The first RAID chromogen is used in this assay. We recommend using either EcoMount or VectorMount media to best preserve the staining signal. Here, we show a duplex assay for two c-MET positive tumor cores, CORE2E2 on the left panel and CORE2A2 on the right. c-MET is a tumor antigen and the signal is seen in red color in both the cores. CORE2E2 on the left is a PD-L1 positive tumor, where PD-L1 is shown in green, while CORE2A2 on the right is a PD-L1 negative tumor where the green staining is absent. In the chromogenic assay, C1 will be visualized in green and C2 probe will be visualized in red. A few critical points to note here are sensitivity of the both red and green chromogens to alcohol. Therefore, this should not be dehydrated using alcohol prior to mounting. Additionally, in a duplex assay, you are detecting two targets and the assay duration therefore is longer. We recommend that you consider splitting this assay into 2 days, where you can store your hybridized slides in 5x SSC overnight. Coming to fluorescent multiplex V1 assay, this is used for detection up to 3 targets. Here you can use different AMP4 alternatives A, B, or C for the different fluorophore combinations. Mounted media to preserve the fluorescent signal. RNAscope multiplex V2 assay can be used for detection up to 4 targets. This is a TSA-based assay, and TSA plus fluorophores or opal dyes are used that are required to be purchased from Buckingham-Elmer or Akoya. Again, we recommend prolonged gold antiphate as the mounting medium. Triplex is also a manual fluorescent multiplex assay and may be used for detection of up to 8 or 12 mRNA targets on the same tissue section. Here too, there is a single probe hybridization step, and this is followed by iterative fluorescent detection in 3 rounds of 4 targets each. Triplex assay utilizes cleavable fluorophores for AF488, ATO550, ATO647N, and AF750. Currently, Triplex is recommended for fresh frozen and fixed frozen samples only. And as in other fluorescent assays, prolonged gold is the recommended mounting medium. This slide here summarizes the general tips that we discussed to ensure success with your RNAscope assays. First, follow the protocols. We have various protocols with necessary details to help address the best way to run the assay. And the protocols are divided into 2 parts. Part 1 is for sample preparation and pretreatment. Part 2 is for running the assay. Next, sample pretreatment is very important to ensure that you get optimal RNAscope signal. The pretreatment conditions will differ based on sample type and may require some optimization. Third, using controls is highly recommended, especially when you are troubleshooting your assay or you are starting as a new user to assess the RNA quality of your samples. And lastly, it is critical to make sure that you have all the components required to run the assay before you begin your experiment. Slide here shows the standard RNAscope reagent kit configuration. Each kit includes pretreatment reagents, detection kit, and wash buffer. The probes are not shown here. We also have accessories like the control probes, the hydrophobic marker pen and mounting medias, and cell pellets. So to make things easier, we have intro packs together with the reagent kits and accessories. Shown here are some recommended accessories required for running the manual RNAscope assays. The Hi-Busy hybridization system shown on top right is a critical component of the assay. It is designed to maintain the optimal temperature and humidity conditions to ensure consistent RNAscope staining. Also shown are 2 methods for carrying out the heat-mediated target retrieval step that is required for some sample types such as paraffin sections, FFP, and fixed frozen. Our website has step-by-step training videos, which is a great visual guide to assist you with running the RNAscope manual assay. Now let's review some troubleshooting examples and the results after performing optimization on these samples. When running the RNAscope assay, here are a few factors that could affect the outcome of your results, like sample fixation may not be optimal, RNA may be degraded in the samples, samples may be drying out, and so on. These factors and issues can be addressed by using the recommended sample fixation conditions and instruments. You must also start with the standard pretreatment conditions outlined in our protocol and then optimize the conditions as required. Here are some potential reasons why you need to optimize. If the samples are underfixed, this can usually lead to over-digestion of your samples using the standard conditions. If your samples are overfixed, then signal could be weak and you may need to optimize. There are also some special sample types that could require different pretreatment conditions and optimizations. A few are listed here, like liver, muscle, and etc. If your tissue of interest is not listed and you are unsure if your tissue has been fixed as per our recommendation, please feel free to reach us and we will assist you in choosing the right pretreatment conditions. Sample pretreatment is a very critical step, as I have mentioned, to be successful with your RNAscope assay. When running the RNAscope assay on your samples, begin with the recommended conditions for your sample type. Observe the signal intensity and background with control probes. Also, check the tissue morphology. If recommendations for your sample type are not available in the user manual, it is always best to start with standard conditions. This will help to set a baseline for how the assay performs. And depending on your results, we can make recommendations to either scale the pretreatment up or down. This slide shows optimal digestion of a tissue fixed as per ACD's protocol recommendation and treated with standard pretreatment conditions. PPIB staining is strong while DAPB negative control is clean. Tissue morphology is intact and hematoxylin staining is homogeneous. Now, compared to the previous slide, this image shows a tissue that has been over-digested, in which the nuclei are now undefined due to suboptimal tissue morphology, and the PPIB staining is slightly weaker than expected. So here is what we have done. The target retrieval was reduced to 8 minutes. And that improved the morphology and eliminated the background seen in the negative control. And now, compared to the image on your left, you can see better morphology and better signal resolution after using the target retrieval time. On the other hand, here are samples that are under-digested. The PPIB staining is much weaker, but the tissue morphology looks intact. So here, the target retrieval time was increased to 30 minutes, which improved signal intensity and resolution, and also eliminated trapping of the chromogen as seen in the image on the left. Shown on the right panel is an image of RNAscope performed on a sample that was fixed for too long. As you can see, the signal is very weak. To avoid such issues, we highly recommend following the sample fixation steps provided in our user manual. You should see images like these ones. This is using the AMP4ALT1 option and was performed on the HeLa control cell palette with human 3-flex positive control probes. Examples of fresh frozen samples where the effect of protease treatment on RNAscope signal quality is demonstrated. In the top two panels are the mouse kidney samples. On the left is the kidney sample that is over-digested due to protease 4 treatment at 40 degrees, but bringing the protease incubation to room temperature resulted in optimal sample digestion. And you can see clear green and red punctured dots. Similarly, the bottom two panels show examples of mouse brain, where optimum protease treatment at room temperature gives a better signal-to-noise ratio compared to the over-digested sample that shows the high amount tissue autofluorescence background. Tissue autofluorescence is a known issue with some sample types, particularly FFPE samples. This poses challenges for image analysis. One approach is to use ground correction softwares to reduce autofluorescence. With our multiplex fluorescent V2 assay, since you have the flexibility of choosing the opal fluorophores that you want to work with, we suggest either avoiding the channels that tend to show high tissue autofluorescence or use them to visualize the high expressors. If you still continue to experience autofluorescence issues with your assay, please feel free to contact our team and we'll be happy to troubleshoot further. Another important thing to address is tissue detachment issues. We recommend using only the SuperFrost Plus slides. If your samples are not adhering to the slides properly, the likely cause may be the ones listed here. We have found that adding an additional baking step can help mitigate this issue. These apply to all sample types and all assay types. If you are observing sample detachment after hydrogen peroxide or target retrieval treatment, then adding a baking step before H2O2 incubation can help. If you are observing tissue detachment after the protease treatment, then add an additional baking step after target retrieval. Both baking steps are for 30 minutes at 60 degrees in a circulating oven. For sample detachment issues with fixed frozen tissues, we recommend drying the slides at minus 20 for 2 hours after cryosectioning. Add a post-fixation step before H2O2 and target retrieval treatment, the duration of which can extend anywhere from 15 minutes to 2 hours at room temperature. That depends on your sample. In most cases, we have seen that the sample detachment happens after target retrieval. So we recommend adding an additional baking step before the protease treatment. If you continue to see tissue detachment, we then recommend that you omit the target retrieval and extend your protease time up to 45 minutes. Also, please contact us and we can help you to figure out the best way to solve this issue. For probe-related troubleshooting, if you are working with these two scenarios listed here, please contact us for knockout validations, as we have thousands of probes currently in the inventory. We would like to help ensure that the probe you are picking is specific for your wild type versus knockout validation. Similarly, if you are working with a novel gene and no catalog probe is available, feel free to contact us and submit your request via our website and to perform a design feasibility test. And our probe design team will contact you shortly. We provide recommended sample preparation protocols for most commonly used sample types. If you are working with some unique sample types, such as hole mount, pre-floating, or bone, please feel free to contact us for suggestions and guidance. One of the most frequently asked question is, can we combine this RNAscope-ish with protein detection, such as immunohistochemistry or immunofluorescence? And the answer for this is yes, you most certainly can. Both ISH and IHC procedures have similar workflows as shown here. Both require sample fixation, some kind of pretreatment to unmask your RNA or protein, and subsequent detection. The recommended workflow is shown here. You would pretreat and permeabilize your tissue or cells first. Depending on the tissue, This may require both a heat-mediated target retrieval as well as a protease digestion. You would then complete the RNAscope-ish portion and then follow with the IHC staining after. However, since RNAscope includes the protease treatment step that can diminish your protein signal, we suggest that you empirically optimize the protease treatment in order to achieve a good balance between your RNA signal and the protein signal. Here is an example of using the RNAscope singleplex RAID assay to detect the PD-L1 probe using ISH with subsequent IHC staining using TIL for CD45 protein. So far, we have talked about how the technology works and the various assay workflows. Now let's discuss how to analyze the assay results. RNAscope staining can be quantified by manually counting the number of dots per cell. This is also known as the semi-quantitative scoring method. With this method, a score of 0 to 4 is assigned based on the average number of dots per cell. We have a guideline document on our website that you can download that describes the different methodologies to quantify your results. If you have further questions, please contact us for recommendations. Some questions that you may have at this point are, what does a dot mean? What is the significance of dot size? And what is the difference between a dot and a cluster? In this image, where an RNAscope chromogenic RAID assay has been performed, the signal appears as numerous punctate RAID dots of various sizes and intensities, and as well as there are a few clusters. It is the number of dots that are important, rather than the size of the dot or the intensity of the dot. Each punctate dot, as shown by the blue arrow, represents one mRNA molecule. The slightly larger, darker red punctate dot shown by the yellow arrow is also one mRNA molecule. However, it is larger in size as more number of ZZ probes have bound to the target molecule. In contrast, a cluster shown by the brown arrow is kind of oblong shape with slightly irregular border and is the result of overlapping signals from multiple mRNA copies. And that could be the where the translation machinery is. Similar pattern of dots and clusters are seen in the fluorescent versions of this assay as well. The yellow arrows point to single mRNA molecules with fewer ZZ probe pairs bound to them compared to the dot shown by the teal arrow. The white arrow is pointing to a cluster with an irregular shape due to overlapping signals from multiple mRNA molecules. A quantitative way to analyze RNAscope data that is more objective and rapid is by using automated software analysis platforms, such as the Halo software systems from the Indica Labs. And we can also use free image analysis softwares, such as ImageJ and Cell Profiler. We have both the tech notes available in our website. Now, keeping in mind the global SARS-CoV-2 pandemic issue, we thought that it would be great to show you all the ACD Bio portfolio to perform COVID-19 related research. The RNAscope SARS-CoV-2 specific probes can be used in tissues and cells to detect the viral distribution and infection. Applying the RNAscope technology to your COVID-19 research can provide new insights into the pathogenesis of this virus and aid in vaccine and drug development. Using the RNAscope multiplex assays, the viral probes can be combined with probes for the cellular receptors such as ACE2 and proteases such as TMPRSS2, cathepsin B and cathepsin L, all of which facilitate viral entry into the host cells for visualization of the infected cells. The single molecule sensitivity of RNA scope is particularly well suited for detecting low levels of S2 expression and identifying virus targeted cell types. Patients with severe COVID-19 infections suffer from acute respiratory distress syndrome, which is induced by the release of cytokines such as IL-6, IL-1 beta, IL-10, and TNF-alpha. Three RNAscope assays can identify the cells secreting all these inflammatory cytokines. And one can use the multiplex fluorescent RNAscope assays to visualize all of them on a single tissue section. In this slide, I'd like to share a very recent publication from the US Army Medical Research Institute of Infectious Disease, where the scientist has used RNAscope technology to understand the pathogenesis of SARS-CoV-2 infection. Using the RNAscope red chromogenic assay, they detected the SARS-CoV-2 spike-like spike protein RNA and the replicative intermediate RNA in FFP cell palates. Later, the RNAscope multiplex V2 assay was used to simultaneously visualize the positive and the negative spike protein mRNA in the same sample. So the positive is being detected as red color and the negative is being detected as green color. In this slide, I have summarized the available RNAscope tools and the recently updated ACD Bio webpage dedicated for COVID-19 related research. As mentioned earlier during the presentation, we have over 2,700 peer-reviewed publications that use our RNAscope and BaseScope technologies. Many of these papers, either as full text or as abstracts, are available at our website. Please visit the link provided to view and access this publication list. With this, we have come to the end of this presentation. We will continue to be online for a few more minutes. Please feel free to send in questions to our panelists who are waiting for you to answer live in the Q&A window. Thank you all.